And let's see, I'll be talking about, the talk will be in two parts. Number one, I'll be talking about some general things in data analytics, which you already know, but for the sake of completion or sake of a complete lecture here, I'll be talking about data analytics, a few slides. Then I'll be talking about data analytics, which are the set of classical network data analytic algorithms, which are very well known to most of the people. And then we'll be talking about basically about deep learning and how deep learning has forged into network data analytics. So initially, some introduction followed by classical net data analytics or network data analytics algorithms or techniques, followed by deep learning in network data analytics. So let's have a go. So as you already know, what is important today is data, and we are getting data from all sources. And as Professor Manish may have already told you, and others may have told you, that we, instead of going out to collect data, we are able to collect data automatically. Automatically, in the sense, we can query for data, we can subscribe for data. And through IoT, we can get data in real time. So we are getting data, and we are getting lots and lots of data. So the collection of data through IoT, through any other means, or having historical data is fundamental to all analytics. And when I say analytics, people from business world have really been a beneficiary of this. Right from their applications to medical, to education, to e-commerce, everywhere, the collection of data and its analysis has become fundamental to business. Not just business analytics, but to business. And since we are collecting data all the time, data is coming in different forms. It's heterogeneous data. It's large amount of data. It's coming and going. So we also have streaming data. We have real-time data. So we need to handle this data and understand what is data saying to us. So what data tells us and what we can tell about the future is what is data analytics all about. So if you look at 1990s, we did not have a very automated way of data collection. So what we wanted, we were collecting data. And when you collect data of all forms, then first thing that you need to do is identify available data in an organization, collect all data from various sources, convert that raw data into usable form, and then generate reports using some Lotus 1-2-3 or Excel or something of that sort, which was available at that time. So it was basically a spreadsheet. You have to manually enter data and then generate reports. By 90s, we began to analyze data not as a spreadsheet only, but we started using programming languages to understand data. And what it did, it made it possible for us to see what was happening and, in some cases, why it was happening. So we could look a little behind the data and find out not only what was happening, but why it was happening, why of things began to unfold. But then we wanted to look at how decisions in the boardroom, how decisions in the field, what we do in the field is a function of what decisions we have taken. We wanted to understand what are the true drivers of performance so that we can predict future and then plan for the future. So because of this, we said that, okay, we'll start collecting data, and we had lots and lots of data so that we could see and see behind the data and find out true drivers of our performance. So we started using AI-based techniques. And when I say AI, we all have the classical AI, we have machine learning, we have deep learning, and we wanted to handle a large amount of data, not just volume, but variety. We wanted to handle veracity. We wanted to handle noise. We wanted to handle so many V's, and big data was born. So the data was not just increasing in volume, it was going into higher dimension. And in the higher dimension, it was not that every data was homogeneous, it was becoming heterogeneous. It was becoming structured, unstructured, all types of data were arriving. So data management became as important as operating on the data. And again, you had wonderful sessions on how tools have been developed to handle data, to have algorithms in the distributed world. And we have tools like Hadoop, MapReduce, not to say what are the Sparks, to be able to not only handle large amount of data, but also have algorithms that can operate on this large amount of data. And what we want? We wanted that people who are domain experts and not computer experts could use these tools. So we wanted, since the data was large, we cannot have domain experts all the time, we cannot have computer experts all the time. So we said, okay, anyone should be able to analyze and visualize trends in real time, pinpoint business problems, and make informed business decisions. That means we can have a team, we can have an army of people using these tools, giving their inputs to the business world, for example, we have so much of data and we give this all, instead of giving the data to the doctor, we could give the trends, we could say what are the problems, so that the tool could come up with some decisions which the doctor can then verify, change, or see it in its own domain light or experience. So the business analysis, or when I say business, it's not just the business that we know of. The business is medical business, education business, any business, health business, e-commerce, obviously, is no longer domain of computer science professionals. We have given tools, and anyone, we don't even need a domain management expert. Anyone can make informed decisions. Obviously, that will aid the expert or the decision maker. So we have tools specific to finance, specific to manufacturing, specific to healthcare, specific to sales, marketing, supply chain, operations. Every aspect of human life and business is touched. So you have data, you have lots of data, you have automated way of collecting data. We have data as per our query. We have data as which is all the time coming. We have streaming data, we have real-time data, we have heterogeneous data. So data is there. And we have now means of handling data and large amount of data, which is a field in its own right, which is big data. But we need to operate. And for operation, we need data analytics. So we must learn to apply analytics skills in real world. And what we need to have the most important thing, the data-driven approach to problem solving. And what is that? See, when we were doing something, people wanted to know if my ward has cleared a joint entrance examination, what branch he should take. So he'll go to an expert, he'll go to the person in the coaching, or he'll go to a professor, or he'll go to a relative who has already done his engineering and would ask a question. Which branch should I take? But now, in addition to this, what becomes more important is data-driven approach. You see what are the trends of people who are taking what branches, and you have websites which have this data-driven approach. You'll say, okay, last year, this was the placement scenario. This is the people who went. This was the placement scene. These are the teachers. These are faculty profiles. This is the location. And hence, this is the branch you should take in such and such institution. Not only that, look at the institutions. They have increased. For example, there are 30 sections in one branch in a particular institute. Institutions are taking 2,000, 3,000 4,000 seats in computer science, whereas mechanical, civil, electrical, they are all drying up. Why? Because it is data-driven approach to problem solving, to decision making, and not some expert who says that, okay, mechanical is evergreen. No, the data says otherwise, and hence we solve the problem using the large amount of data that we have. And what we need for that? We need descriptive and inferential statistics. We need to have a hypothesis and test that hypothesis. We need regression analysis to know the trends. We need to blend data which are heterogeneous. We need to have précis of data which are data extracts. We need to forecast. We must have forecasting tools. Now, the data is not isolated. When we sense data and we gather data, the data points are not isolated. For example, when I buy something or when I choose a branch, then my relative rank is important. Where I stay is important vis-à-vis the institute. It is important how much money I have in the bank. It is important what my interest is. It's important what my background is. If I have a business, probably I'll go and not take computer science. I'll take something civil because I have a civil firm. If I have a law firm, I'll take the law as a branch, 5-year law. So the data is not isolated, but everyone from the human being to the colleges to other businesses, for example, in education, they are all connected. And hence, not only the individual is important, his features are important, but his connection also becomes very, very important. So the network analytics is the practice of using different types of network data. That means not only the individual features of nodes, but also their connections to the outside world to identify trends and patterns. So the network here is not just the wireless or the wired network. It's not just the social network. It's not just the friend circle. It's not just the citation network. It is any dependence of an individual on other individuals, his practices, other features, his connection to items. So what becomes important is not only our own individual node features, but also the structure and dependence on other nodes, items, so on and so forth. And hence, if you are able to take into account not just the node features and their isolations, but also the dependence on my neighboring nodes and their features, then network analytics becomes important, and that is network analytics. And this information can be used to take better decisions, can be used to take troubleshooting decisions, for example, in a wireless or a wired network. We can also have, for example, in a network, we can talk in terms of threat and threat remediation. For example, in a wireless network, there can be a malware attack. On a social network, there can be a malware attack. There can be anomalies. There can be outliers. And the network data and the network characteristics can be used to make better decisions and better planning of whatever we are doing. So, what are the challenges in data analytics? And more so in network data analytics is tremendous volume of data, heterogeneous structures, high dimension, which means that there are so many features. Any node has millions of features nowadays. For example, an image can have a million features. The diversity, it's not just image, it's video, it's human beings, it is their taste, it is the trend, it is the OTT platforms, all form a network. So there is a wide variety of data. And what we need is what Dr. Manish told you in the very first lecture, that we need to have efficient data mining schemes. Because of the tremendous volume of data of large networks, we need to have efficient data mining schemes which can then handle this large amount of data. And we can have, for example, big data scenarios where we can have distributed data mining schemes. Example, you can have distributed k nearest neighbor in a cloud environment to take decisions. And obviously, if you remember the first lecture that you had in this particular workshop, is the conventional, for example, association rules. So you cannot really apply conventional multi-pass data mining schemes because of the volume of data. Not only that, the data is connected also. So, and the data is noisy. So it's critical to mitigate the data errors. It's critical to mitigate the, take into consideration the uncertainty in the data, especially in network systems. Because if you have a wrong connection, if you have a give a wrong structure of the network, the entire decision making comes wrong because the nodes are no longer in isolation. The data is not in isolation. But then, if you have an IoT, say, in an IoT, you will find that it senses data. Suppose you have a medical data, then why should I let anybody sense my private data? For example, I have a disease and I don't want anyone to know. Also, I don't want the insurance people to know. Then during data collection, privacy of data becomes very important. And not only that, if I want to, I'm doing some analysis and I'm using some analytical tool, I don't want the analytical tool which is lying on the cloud to know my decisions or my data and the privacy of the data, not only during data collection, but also during analysis becomes very important. So what we want is not just the data privacy during collection, but we also want data privacy during the mining process or the machine learning process or any data analytical scheme applied to network data with huge volume, heterogeneous structure, various types of data types, spatio-temporal correlations. The conventional privacy preserving techniques may not work because they are there to preserve the privacy of the data, not of the data being operated upon, not the privacy of the prediction process. So we need to have more different types of privacy preserving techniques for privacy preserving learning or machine learning or deep learning or any other data analytics process. We may have streaming data, so we have a real-time environment because, for example, in an IoT or in a VANET type of situation, you are getting data all the time. Because, for example, if you have seen Professor U.S. Tiwari's lecture, if you have self-driven cars, autonomous vehicles, then the data is coming in real time. You have to take decisions in real time. And we have to take a mine different data, so you need to have high accuracy. For example, in autonomous vehicles, you need to have very high accuracy because human life is involved, and we have to take decisions in real time. And the most important thing from our point of view, the data is spatially and temporally correlated. Not only the data has large scale, but the data is spatially and temporally correlated. That means the network data. And we must learn both from individual data, that means the node features, as well as the network structure. So as you already know, we need data analytics method lie in three broad categories. We have descriptive methods, we have predictive method analytics, and we have prescriptive analytics. I'll not go into details because we already know, and we have a lecture on prescriptive analytics by Professor O.P. Vyas on the last day tomorrow. So I'll not dwell onto this, but just a little bit. So example, in descriptive analytics, we have techniques which are explorative analysis, association rule mining, clustering, sequential pattern matching, descriptive statistics. And what we want to know, we want to analyze data. So we go in for network performance analysis, misbehavior pattern, mobility pattern, content analysis. That means we are looking inside the data. But if you want to predict from the data, Then we go for predictive analysis. Analytics, as the name is clear, you want to predict something from data. Classification, regression, anomaly detection, inferential statistics, deep learning, supervised learning, semi-supervised learning, self-supervised learning, unsupervised learning, all flavors of learning is, what is learning? We want to predict, we want to generalize. There can be multiple applications, right from decision-making, trajectory prediction to any damn thing. But this is not sufficient. We must be able to take decisions in the domain. So we must have prescriptive analysis. For example, the doctor gives you prescription after seeing all data. So he gives you his diagnosis or prescription. So we need to use both descriptive as well as predictive analytics and use them to take decisions. So let's have a quick look. So descriptive analysis for analytics, what it does, it utilizes the existing data sets to look into the data. Then, for example, we have sequential pattern matching and we have descriptive statistics, association rule, mining, clustering, which you have already seen. The predictive analysis, what we do is we learn, we generalize. So we have all types of learning. Supervised, unsupervised, deep learning, semi-supervised learning, and so on and so forth. And what we can do out of it, as you have already seen, we can go in for anomaly detection, can go in for inferential statistics, we can go in for stochastic modeling. That means you are able to predict from data. You are able to infer from data. And that is what is predictive analytics. All machine learning, all deep learning falls into this particular domain. However, as I said, this is not enough. And prescriptive analytics extends the result of both what is inside the data, which is descriptive analysis, and what is the learning from the data, which is predictive analysis, to take decisions. And therein, you need an expert who joins it, who joins all these things. And the domain expert uses simulation. That means he'll use both the descriptive and predictive analytics by mimicking the scenarios as to how does this decision fit into my domain? Or he can use optimization by maximizing or minimizing certain outcomes and do decision making by finding out what are his objectives, what are the alternatives, I can do this, I can do that, and then select. So prescriptive analysis is all having the expert or the automated expert to take decisions by combining descriptive and prescriptive analysis. And finally, we can learn, and we can have algorithms which can learn and plan using their experience, and that is reinforcement. So here, agents are able to learn by interaction with the environment by a process of penalty and reward. But then, why is this important? So now we enter into our world of network analytics. Why is network analytics, which is say learning from nodes, features, and the structure of their connections, the network itself, the structure of the network, how is that important and why it is important? So why it is important? Because network analytics is best leveraged to model interactions between entities and get insights focusing on the interactions. By focusing on the interactions, you get insights. And we concentrate not only on the individual entity, but also on its relationship, its interactions with the outside world. And my interactions with my outside world gives information about me. That is the idea. My interactions with the outside world, with my neighbors, with my book, with my computer, with my mobile, with my friends, with what I eat, what medicines I take, all these interactions give information about me. and this information we get from network analytics. And that's what makes it important. So as soon as we say this, let's see, what we are doing is we are taking the network, and then apart from looking at the individual features, the characteristics of the individual, we are looking at the structure of the network. And therein, the first structure that we look, for example, when we have data, for what do we do with the data? We find out the mean. So when we look at the network, what we are talking about is the centrality analytics, the measures of centrality. For example, we have the measures of centrality in data, mean, median, mode. So likewise, in a network, we say that we have centrality analytics. So what do you mean by centrality of a graph or a network? So we say that the centrality, for example, when you give marks to students, we find out the average, grade point average. So grading itself, so we want to find out what is the average performance. What is average? It's a centrality index. So what is centrality in a graph or a network? So centrality is used to identify the most central nodes in a network or graph. So the importance of that particular node is gauged by its centrality. So we define a metric which is called degree of centrality. So the degree of centrality is the ratio of the total actual number, actual neighbor of a particular node compared to the total possible number of neighbors that a node can have. So the degree of centrality can give me the importance of a node. So we want to measure it. And when we measure it, how we measure it? We measure it finding out the actual number of neighbors of a node and the total possible number of neighbors of a node that we can have. So it measures, and what do you know? We can find out the degree of centrality of every node and rank them. So we can find out who are the key entities. All the centrality tells us which node is important. So we are able to identify the key entities. For example, we can find out who are the most influential people in a social network. What are the key transportation hubs? What are the main market hubs in Allahabad? What are the main transportation hubs in Allahabad? What are the main offices in Allahabad? So all this can be made available finding out the degree of centrality and doing centrality analytics. So there are different algorithms and types of questions they answer. So centrality index, as you can see, is very easy and it's very intuitive, and we have been using it for such a long time. For example, we can say the degree of a particular node. The higher the degree of a particular node, that means the more neighbors it has, the more connections it has, the more important it is. Or what we can have, the betweenness. So how many paths go through this particular? So what is the amount of flow? So for example, the Naini Bridge, we have to find out which road in Allahabad, the Prayagraj, is the lifeline of Prayagraj. So that will tell us what is that important. So that particular node will allow us to do maximum preventive maintenance because that is the lifeline. In our own IIIT Allahabad, we find out what is the most important connection, network connection, which is important, which is the most important path, which is important. So we place the fastest router and the best switch and have a multi-core optical connection through that. So betweenness is very, very important. Likewise, what is the closeness? That is, which particular node is closest to all other nodes. That means if you find out the shortest path from one node to all other nodes, then we find out the node which is most easily reachable. So for example, in this particular graph, if you look at B, is closest with fewest hops in the subgraph. And here it is, the fourth one. For example, if you look at page rank, so page rank tells us which node is important, and we know page rank and its variant, for example, are used by Google to find out the importance of a particular page, a particular website, or a vertical web page. So page rank tells us which node is important. For example, in this particular case, D is the foremost based on number and the weighing of the links. However, E is more important than all other nodes except D because of its proximity to D. There is a mutual influence between E and D, which makes E also important. However, if you look at the connectivity, if you look at the page rank, D has the maximum page rank. So let's have a look at the algorithms which are used for centrality and the types of questions they answer. So we have, for example, the first algorithm, the easiest one and the most obvious one, is the degree centrality. What it does, it measures the number of relations. The more related I am, the more important I am. So it estimates a person's popularity. For example, in our Twitter, the number of followers that I have, the number of people that I follow, gives me my popularity. And what is more important is the in degree. So the in degree gives me my popularity. The out degree gives me how social I am, how gregarious I am. The closeness centrality, for example, what are the variations, for example, there are different variations, the harmonic centrality, the Wassermann-Faust closeness centrality. But what does it say? It calculates which nodes have the shortest path going through them. So example, there is a bridge connecting Allahabad and Naini. So if you calculate all the shortest path, many of the shortest path will be going through Civil Lines Road or will be going through the bridge. So the nodes which are a part of the shortest path of all other nodes, obviously that is a lifeline. So that is the optimal location of all new public services, because the public service, that all public services, all public offices, the SP office, the DM office, the hospitals, the Aadhaar office, all should be located near these nodes for maximum accessibility. So we, by analyzing the graph, the closeness centrality, we can go into this. So now, not only the closeness centrality, but also the betweenness centrality. So it measures the number of shortest paths that pass through a node. What is closeness centrality? Calculates which nodes are the shortest path to all other nodes. And what is the betweenness centrality? Measures the total number of shortest paths that go through a particular node. So my friends, for example, you are analyzing the coronavirus. Now you know that in this particular coronavirus structure, this is the some part of the node, some part of the virus in through which all interaction, protein interactions are taking place. So you have a drug which will actually attack that particular control gene, will be able to attract that particular control gene, and then we'll be able to tell which gene is important. And hence, what happens is that between the centrality then becomes very important. Likewise, we know, all know, that page rank is important, and page rank estimates the current nodes important from its neighbors and their neighbors. Not just local influences taken into consideration, but non-local influences also taken into consideration. So we can do ranking. We can do, for example, all NLP, as Dr. K.P. Singh may have told you, requires to calculate the influence of the, if you want to do translation, you want to do transliteration, you want to do anaphora detection or disambiguation, all these can be done using PageRank. Then, in addition to the centrality index or centrality analytics, we could go in for connectivity analytics not only the nodes are important, but their connections are important. What type of connections? So the centrality in analytics, what it does, tries to find out the key nodes. And what does the connectivity analytics? It focuses on these unique characteristics of node connections. So we can focus on the characteristics of the connections, the edges in a graph or the connections in a network, not just the key nodes. So, for example, we can have the comparison between inflow and outflow edges. Let's look at this, how this becomes very important. For example, you're doing anomaly detection, or you are doing malware detection, or you are doing fraud detection. So the idea comes from the domain. It says, if a person is doing a fraud, then he must be doing a lot of transactions, small transactions. And he'll be a new person trying to connect to multiple people. So if you can model the user accounts and transactions, and you then have some knowledge that this particular person is a potential fraudulent user, or he had run frauds before, then you can put a limit to their interactions. So somebody who tries to give a PIN number all the wrong PIN number all the time, where the interactions are coming and is claiming to be other persons all the time, can put a limit to his transaction, even though he's a legitimate user, because he may be a potential fraud. What are the algorithms? As you can see, we are not just concentrating on the node, but also on the structure of the graph or structure of the node. So example, you can identify the clicks. And one click is a triangle count. For example, we concentrate on clicks and concentrate, for example, on the triangle count. So the number of triangles that pass through a particular node, the number of clicks that a node A is 42. The clustering coefficient, the probability that neighbors of a node are connected to each other, is the clustering coefficient. So I can find out the number of clicks a particular node is a part of, the clustering coefficient. So we can find out the clustering coefficient taken into account. So we know that any two nodes which have 20% chance of being connected together can be given. The probability of how a node is connected to other nodes can be obtained through clustering coefficient. You can have connected components. The components which says that all nodes which can be reached regardless of the direction in a directed graph. The strongly connected components, which says in a directed graph, it can be reached two needs which can be nodes which can be reached from both directions. So in the connected component, we are saying set of all nodes which can be reached from all other nodes, irrespective of the direction. But if you take the bidirectional reachability, then we say that the components are strongly connected. We can have label propagation algorithms, for example. So we say that if I am studying in IIIT Allahabad, who others are there? If I have a certain taste, who others will have similar tastes? So I propagate the algorithm saying that if the persons who are close to me in a dense cluster, we share labels. So the labels can spread to and from neighbors to find clusters of people. So in a particular friend graph, we can find out the cluster representing, for example, the persons who are attending this FDP. Or you can find out the popularity. For example, there is a community detection software algorithm, which is the Lovane modularity algorithm. What it does, it is, as I said, it is a connectivity analytics algorithm. And what it does, it finds out the communities, it finds out the clusters. What it does, it first finds out small communities and then it fuses these small communities into a super node and repeats the algorithm. So what we can do is it can find clusters by moving into higher relation density groups and aggregating these super communities. So by multiple iterations, as you can see in this particular figure, what it does, it is able to fuse the nodes to find clusters and fuse them together to find out clusters which are super communities through a multiple iterations. And we can find groups, and we can repeat this to find out different communities and do community analytics here. So what is important, not the nodes which are given by the centrality analytics, the connectivity analytics tells you what paths, what are the clusters or groups which are important, how is the structure important, how is the connection important. But the path analytics gives you the desired path to move in between nodes. So if you know how two nodes are connected, given two nodes, how they are connected, we can go in for path analytics. So how far I am to a JEE topper, how far I am to an MIT professor in publications, how far I am to my own colleague. So that can be gauged using the path analytics. And we are already using it, the shortest path algorithms and all other flavors of algorithms. The shortest path algorithms allow us to do path analytics. Use cases being figuring out the shortest time to travel between cities. How do you travel in the time of congestion? In a supply chain, finding out the distribution between distribution central location. For example, the big bazaar, when it designs to feed in its big bazaar outlets, tries to find out what routes its buses or the storage vans should take. What should be the central location of their go downs? For example, Amazon has go down in Unnao and not in Allahabad. So they use these path analytics to find out wherein we should have the path and what is the best way to move between cities to deliver the goods. We know. We already been studying this in our own BTech on itself. So we have breadth first search. For example, you want to visit the nearest neighbors first. We want to go in for depth first search. We walk down each branch first. Or in addition to these graph search algorithms, and we can use heuristics. For example, you can go to A star algorithm also. We can have graph partitioning algorithms. So you can use, for example, the shortest path algorithms like Warshall-Floyd or Belman-Ford or Dijkstra algorithm. We can have all pairs shortest path. For example, we can have all pairs shortest path algorithms, and for example, the Warshall-Floyd gives you the all pairs shortest paths. We can have single source shortest path. For example, the Dijkstra algorithm gives you the single source shortest path. We can have minimum spanning tree. We can have, for example, in a wireless network, we can have minimum connected dominating set. We can have connected dominating sets. So we can model the network as a graph. And for path analytics, you can use the shortest path. You can have all pair shortest paths. You can have single source shortest path. We can have minimum connected dominating set. We have minimum spanning tree and the variants of these particular algorithms to do path analytics. Or if you don't want to use this, we can have random path finding process. So what happens in a random path finding process, we can find out communities. So I'll give you an example, and I don't have the example in the slides, but let's see it. It's a very famous and initial algorithm. So there are two parts of a city connected by a bridge, and the river runs between the bridge, between the cities. In between the city, and there is a single bridge. So if I do random walk and I see people doing randomly walking, then I'll see that hardly people, most of the will be confined to the individual parts of the city and not follow the bridge. So I will be able to partition the network or the city into two parts connected by the bridge. And this I can do how? I can ask a person to randomly walk, and I can make him drink a lot of liquor so that he can be a drunkard's walk. And most of the time he'll be wandering within the city, rarely crossing the bridge, and hence I can find out the close-knit communities in a particular graph. So I can do path analytics using random walk algorithms or diffusion algorithms. Let's see one of the techniques which is used for, we have community detection becomes very, very important as we have seen, so that we can find out who are closely knit people, who are friends, who are knit friends, so on and so forth. So we have one set of applications and algorithms for community detection. So what is a community we define? So when we try to define community, then we say that a subset of nodes that are densely connected to each other, we are defining a community, my friends. So what is a community? We say, for example, we have a student community, we have faculty community, we have a non-teaching community, we have business community. What is a community? Set of nodes. If you model the society as a graph, and this particular network or graph, the nodes subset which are densely connected to each other and loosely connected to other nodes, that means you are defining in graph, you are trying to find out a subgraphs or subgraphs which are densely connected to each other and loosely connected to other nodes. This subset is what is a community. And we want to have algorithms or techniques for finding out communities, because community share habits, community share likes, community shares taste, communities have similar characteristics, so we can do a lot of analytics there. So, for example, we can, by detection, community detection, we have different algorithms for it. The most obvious, as you have already seen a distributed version of this, for example, we have K-means clustering methods, simple greedy method. We have graph partition methods. For example, you have already seen we can use, for example, random walk to partition networks. Two cities or a city through which a river runs and it's separated by a bridge. So we can use the graph partitioning to find out the two sides of particular city. We can have more sophisticated method. For example, you can have non-negative matrix factorization methods, which are LMF methods. Modularity optimization methods, for example, Lovane method. We can use probabilistic methods, for example, like topic modeling or MLE or something of that sort, or probabilistic graphical models for community detection. And as you can see, we have so many good papers right from 2001 to 2004 to 2019. We have this is a very, very strong area of research, very vibrant area of research, which is community detection. So let's look at what is a community, and let's look at this very, very important technique. So what is a community? We have already seen that a community is where people are strongly connected to a particular group and weakly, sparsely connected to others. So on the social media platforms, which is a network, we try to connect with other people. But after a while, we end up being connected with the people belonging to different social circles. And these social circles can be group of relatives, schoolmates, colleagues, alumni network, business network, friend network, faculty network, student network, so on and so forth. And these social networks are communities. So if you want to find out what are communities in an automated way, so as you can see, there can be different, if there's a person who wants to target a particular group and he's able to find out a community, then business predictions, business decisions, become easy. So what is community detection? So in a large scale network, you have millions of nodes, and community detection algorithm is partitioning the network. So partitioning of the network in some manner is what is community detection. And what is community analytics? We find several central nodes and discover groups or communities between them. So for example, Amitabh Bachchan is a central node, and my own director is a central node. Then we find out groups and communities between them. For example, in a social network like Instagram, apart from their friends and relatives, people also are following accounts which spike their interest. For example, the movies, Udham Singh, for example, or Sher Shah, for example. Or if you like photography, food, fashion, mobiles, and mapping these connections, we can extract the communities and create recommendations. So one very, very important application of community analytics is a recommender system. What are the classical algorithms which you have already seen? For example, we have triangle count or clicks, for example, the clustering coefficient. What it does, it measures how many nodes form clicks or triangles and the degree to which the nodes tend to cluster together. So you can find out the group stability, you can have the small world phenomenon, so on and so forth. We have strongly connected components. That means finding groups where each node can be reachable from every other node in the same group following the direction of relations. So you can have, for example, you have person item relationship. So you can make a product recommendation. You can have connected components. You can have, as I already shown you, you can have label propagation. You can have infer clusters. Example, you can understand consensus. The people with similar views, people with similar views trying to plan, do some plan some community hatred or planning some terrorist operation. Or in the drug world, you can see what are the drugs which can have very bad side effects. Similarly, we can have low-end modularity, can be used for fraud analysis. So we have already seen these. So let's look at one algorithm which is very, very important and is becoming very important, which is called NMF or non-negative matrix factorization. So what it does, it's a feature extraction and dimensionality reduction technique in machine learning. What it does for community detection, it defines two sets of quantities. For example, the centrality matrix of vertices and a degree matrix of communities. Let's have slight details here. So in non-negative matrix factorization, suppose you have a network and the network, for example, has vertices and it has some items. So what it does, the non-negative matrix factorization, I'll just show you the technique and then I'll see tell you what it does. So we have a matrix, data matrix D of size m cross n. What NMF does, it factorizes, it decomposes the matrix D into two parts, W and H. So D is approximately equal to two non-negative factors, W and H. The matrix W and H are non-negative. And this, what it does? So what it does is this W and H actually tell you the importance of the different vertices and their connections. So taking a graph, and what kind of graph, for example, using this non-negative matrix factorization, I can find out the community membership of each vertex in the network. Example, when you are using D is equal to WH, if you follow my mouse, D is equal to WH, what we can do is we can have the element H can be viewed as membership degree, and the H can be taken as the vertex R. So I can, using this non, and I know it's not getting very, very clear just now, but I want to just give you, impress the idea that we are able to doing D is equal to WH. Each column element in H can be viewed as a membership degree to R communities. So each vertex can be assigned a community with the largest membership. For example, by using this NMF, if you look at this, we are able to partition this particular graph. Now, this particular graph is modeled as an adjacency matrix, represented as an adjacency matrix D, which is partitioned, which is factorized into W and H. And using that, we are able to identify different communities, because you can have vertices with different degrees, and that can tell us the communities. And this has been reported, as you can see, in a 2013 paper in Nature. So let's go back to the original question. How is it going to be useful? So the analytics techniques can be within data network analytics can be useful for numerous real-time applications, my friends. So, for example, it can be used for social media marketing. So the marketers are using social media platform to promote their brands and products by engaging social media influencers. So who should be the influencer? Who is most important in a particular network? So network analytics can help in effectively selecting the influencers. What it uses is connectivity and community analytics. So by using connectivity and community analytics, I can map out the influencer, who can influence others, and the influencers with their followers and the followers' connection. So we have found out who can be the influencer by using their importance in the network, and I can identify the key influencers, their influential followers, so that I can spread my product through word of mouth chain. Example, if IIIT Allahabad is organizing a workshop, then I can use Facebook to influence and spread the information. Whom should I first be targeting? I need to select the influencers on the social media platform, for example, Facebook. So I'll find out who are the influencers. That means the influencers are having large number of followers, and their followers also having large number of followers. So I post my Facebook notification of the Atal workshop with these influencers page, Facebook page, so that it gets maximum dissemination. Fraud detection. Example, we want to have our network, and we want to find out frauds. We can want to know. So we can, fraud is an outlier. We say that's a rare phenomenon. So it's an outlier. So I want to find out outliers from the current transaction patterns and engagement with fraudulent actors. We know that there are some fraudulent actors. We already have identified them, and we wish, how can then we try to use network analytics? I'll give you an example. Anyone who comes and makes a friend and makes friends quickly is a potential fraud. This is what we say, because a person enters into the network friend list, spreads quickly, then all of a sudden it does not do anything, and then it does a fraud and goes away. So any entity which is seen in the network jumping from one place to another, spreading at their wings very, very quickly, and then not doing any useful transaction, and all of a sudden doing one important transaction and then fold away, can be potential frauds. They can be individuals, they can be a group, so we can have the fraud can be a subgraph, the fraud can be an individual, and we can use network analytics to visualize the affinities of such individuals. For example, in an e-commerce product, we can identify a fraudulent user by visualizing their connection with a known fraudulent user. So I know that this person was a potential fraud. He all the time says that I have lost my goods and re-asks for the goods. I can identify a reseller who gives fraud, who gives substandard goods all the time. So I can see that usage of the same delivery address, uses the same credit cards or bank accounts, can point out at different places, can say that, okay, this man seems to be a fraudulent user. Or look at the merchant customer interaction. If there is only one merchant transacted by a single customer, then and that customer has transacted with that merchant multiple times, that means they can be a part of a fraud. They are setting up a fraud product and the person is buying, and a group of persons, a small group of persons are buying from the same product from the same merchant. That means there can be a substandard product here. As you can see, we can have a recommender system here. So within the network, we can identify clusters using community analysis. So we can have a common topic of interest. So we can, for example, we find that people are watching this particular movie Udham Singh a lot many times. And we find that there are other persons who have seen similar movies. So we can recommend this movie on Amazon Prime to these others also. So the assumption is users connected closely have a similar interest. One item that is liked by one user is most likely to be liked by closely connected user. And hence this item can be recommended to them. So that is why Facebook, that is why people like the companies like Google want to connect everything from WhatsApp to YouTube to Google. Why? Because they are able to identify the connections between peoples, and on say for example on a particular OTT platform, they can find out the likes and dislike of a particular person, and hence they'll be in a position to make recommendations, and ultimate aim is to be able to sell a particular product or sell a particular service. Now, as I said, we try to make a U-turn, try to change gears. We say, what is network analytics? We found, we have seen some classic algorithms, very useful algorithms. We have seen some application areas. We have seen path analytics. We have seen community analytics. We have seen, for example, other types of analytics. Now, we say that, okay, network analytics is going to be useful. And how it is going to be useful? The analytic techniques within network analytics can be applied to numerous real-time applications. But then, all these algorithms that you have seen are algorithms which are there when the amount of data was low. We had a small amount of data, we had homogeneous data, we could have small graphs, and we could apply these graph algorithms. The scaling these algorithms was very, very difficult, and it's very, very difficult. We are still trying to scale this data, we're still trying to handle a large amount of data. So instead of just trying to scale these classical algorithms, let's turn to machine learning. Can deep learning, which is a subset of machine learning, and which uses large amount of data, which takes data-driven decision-making, help us in network analytics? So we have already know had an overview of machine learning in Professor K.P. Singh's class. We have talked about transfer learning. We have seen an overview of machine learning and deep learning. So let's turn to deep learning techniques. Can deep learning techniques help network analytics? For the next 45 minutes, my friends, or 1 hour, my friends, we'll be talking about graph representation learning, or we'll be talking of modeling the network as a graph and do representation learning on graphs, or do learning on graphs, and talk about deep learning techniques, or rather we'll concentrate only on graph neural networks for doing network analytics. So we now do a change of gears. We move towards another path, which is graph learning or graph representation learning. So let's move. So let's see. So we are trying to do representation learning in graphs. We say that, okay, we are going to model the network as a graph and try to do some type of representation learning using deep learning techniques. So for that, let's look at deep learning first, my friends. Let's look at deep learning and what makes deep learning great. So first, as we all know, we have data, lots and lots of data. And together with that data, my friends, we also have a lot of computational power. And we have CPUs, we have GPUs, we have cloud computing, we have a lot of computational power. And we have neural networks which could beat the curse of dimensionality. And then, what is the good news? The good news is that even though the data is in very high dimension, we have lots and lots of data, but the data have inherent structures within them. The data has inherent structure. So, and these structures can be joined together. They can be composed together. So the good news is that we have, the news is that we have lots and lots of data coming from different sources, heterogeneous data, as we've seen that data is coming in all forms and flavors. But what we recognize now is that the data has structures, and these structures can be discovered. These structures can be composed together for decision making. So in our universe, data have structures, and structures are compositional. And the blessing of structure says that this data is not random, the data is not uniformly spread in the high dimension. They are structured and they are actually concentrated in the low dimensional space. And they can be composed. For example, the human face, if you take the image, it is 1000 by 1000 pixels image. But we have different structures, like for example, eye, edges, eyebrows, nose, lips, ear, hairline, all these are structures which are not random, which are common. And for decision making, we can combine these low level features to take decisions. So we need techniques which can discover these low level features like edges. For example, if you follow my mouse, you see my mouse, you have a fish and you have different low level features, edges, fins, etc. Then these can be combined together to make the low level, mid level features. For example, eyes, you can have fins, you can have tail, all these can be combined. And then these can be combined to make high level features like ear, lips, etc., which can allow me to do decision making. So what is the news? The news is that we have lots of data. What is the good news is that the data have structures. Structures can be composed together. And the very good news is we have neural networks or convolution neural network we can leverage, which can find out the structure within data, compose these structures using convolution techniques, and then pass it through a nonlinear function to take decisions. And the most important good news is that we have back propagation technique, which allows us to learn from data, allows us to learn the parameters. Learn. So what we have three things. Number one, we have large amount of data which have structures. We can compose, we can find out these structures, we can find the structures using neural networks, we can learn these structures, we can compose these structures to take decisions. So this is the story in one slide. So we have low level features, as you can see in both these figures, which can be combined together to have, so these neural networks can discover the data structures, low level structures. Then it can combine these structures into mid level structures, and then combine them to get high level abstract structures like faces, all the faces all together to do decision making. And we have large number of parameters which can be learned using back propagation. So this is the popular convolutional neural network structure, my friends, in which we have the image. For the first few layers are able to find out the low level features, which are combined together to find and combined together using convolution and pooling to get the mid-level features. We can be combined together to get high-level features, and then finally have decision making using fully connected networks. So the first thing which is important is the convolutional layer, which is able to find out the low-level structures. I will not go into details of this, but we can find out the low-level structures using convolution. And then we can compose these low-level structures using, join them together to find out the complex patterns using, for example, pooling. So pooling allows us to compose these low stationary patterns given to us by convolutional layer to make complex abstract patterns, and then do decision making. So how do we do decision making? We assume, now most importantly, if you look at the image, seems to be a plane. So we say that it's a Euclidean region, because everything is a plane. It's not like the Earth. It's flat. It's not circular. It's not a hemisphere. It is not something which is non-Euclidean. It's Euclidean. So we do all things which are Euclidean and define convolution, do downsampling, use pooling, and then do this quickly to do decision making. However, what happens is that in graph, when you look at a social network, you look at a wireless network, you look at a wired network, you look at the any other friend network, you look at the citation network, you look at the manufacturing line, you look at the health line, you look at hospitals, you look at drug interaction. All these are not flat. They don't form a regular graph. They don't have similar nodes. So when you want to go and learn on the graphs, then CNN will not work. So the real world data sets are actually networks or graphs. Social networks, the knowledge networks, the protein interaction networks, the World Wide Web or the Internet, all these can be modeled as a graph, but they cannot be modeled as a regular graph. They cannot be grids. For example, if you look at biological applications, we have the patient network, we have the hierarchy of cell systems, we have disease pathways, we have genetic interactions. We have gene co-expression networks. We have cell-cell similarity. All these have become very important in this COVID times. But these cannot be modeled as a regular graph, and hence we cannot use CNN on them. So, but what we want, remember, we want, as we saw in network analytics, we want to find out the most important network. So I want to do node classification. I want to find, predict the type of a given node in these. For example, here in this, I want to know which cells are infected, what are the cells which are going to be infected. In a patient network on Aarogya Setu, I find out who are the people, who are the small subgraph who has been infected, who are the individuals who have been infected. I want to do node classification. I want to predict the relation between nodes. So I want to do link prediction. I want to do community detection so that I can, for example, in COVID, I want to find out clusters or hotspots. I want to find out not only just subgraphs, I want to know how similar two nodes or graphs are. So I want network similarity. So in fact, I want to do the entire network analytics using deep learning. However, if I want to do that, if you want to do deep learning, geometric deep learning, then the problem is that we have irregular structures. The graph is not a regular structure like image, audio, text. They have irregular structures. So what we need to do and define, my friends, are convolution and pooling operations so that we can have, can learn on graphs also. So as I said, in modern deep learning, the CNNs or the LSTM or the GRUs are designed for regular structures. For example, if you look here at a piece of tissue, that can be modeled as an image, which is a regular graph. And we can use, for example, the AlexNet or something, or deep CNN or some CNN on this. But, or we can have a time sequence, and this is also regular. So it's a regular 1D structure, and we can define the word to vec, or we can define RNNs on this. But graphs are not like these structures. Graphs are not like this, so that we can define convolution and pooling and something here. So in the graphs, we have no fixed node ordering. If you see my mouse, we have no fixed node ordering. We know that. No reference point where to start. It's not a tree. And mostly the graph evolves. It's dynamic. It's mono. It has multiple features, every node. The connection is irregular. In fact, the data is a non-Euclidean data. And the main challenge is to find out the structures and find out how do you compose these structures. Old problem that data has structures, have isolated structures, small structures, compose these structures to do decision making. Have small, low level structures, combine them, compose them for middle level structures, compose them for high level structures, and then take decisions. So we wish to define convolution and pooling and downsampling on graphs. And obviously make them fast enough as standards. So let's look at one such structure, very important, the cutting edge of today's world, deep learning world, which is called graph neural networks. So one more idea on CNN. So in a CNN, what we do is we do convolution followed by pooling. And I want to do example, here it is. In convolution, what we do is we have a filter. That filter is a dot product between the part of the image and that particular window or filter, and we that. Can we replicate that on a graph? So on a graph, we look at this, and I'm not going to deal with GNN in detail because we are concentrating more on network analytics and not on GNN. But look at what CNN is doing. What convolution is doing? It is taking each node here and it is passing on the effect of this particular, all these nodes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 nodes, to a particular node in green. So the blue grid, in the blue grid, every node in the green grid is affected by a group of nodes in the blue grid. So it is like message passing. So if you look at the right hand side figure, the central node is getting messages from all the nodes, including itself. There is a self loop also. So what is happening? If you look at convolution, what is convolution? Convolution is like a message passing algorithm. Every node in the locality, in the my vicinity, is passing their influence on me or their messages on me. So what is in the mapping graph? We transform the information. So you get information from the neighbors, combine them. So you are getting, for example, the messages from the neighbors, which are HI. WIs are the weights of each, and we add them together. These WIs, remember, in convolution, the weights W1, X1, W2, X2, these weights are learnable weights. These weights, my friends, are learned using back propagation. So in a graph also, we model the convolution process, a spatial convolution process, as a message passing network in which every node gets the message or the influence from its neighboring nodes. And the amount and the weight of the message is learnable. So WIs are learnable weights, which we learn using back. So you can ignore these slides. These are still mathematical, but let's look at this. So we have, for example, a 2D depth map or a 3D point cloud, for example, in which we have broken the entire rabbit into small grids. And this is a graph. Or this lady here, we have modeled, taken, and we have tessellated it into ports with connections. And this is a 4D graph. 4D point cloud. 3D means we have the length, breadth, and depth, and we see the evolution in time also. So we have a 4D dynamic cloud. We can have a plane image, which is 2D. We can have a 3D image. So this is a 3D point cloud, or we can have the evolution, how the hair of this girl is flying, is actually flying in the air. We see as a dynamic graph. So it's a 4D time. What we want, we model the whole thing as a graph and apply graph signal processing. That means we can have graph neural networks. And what is the graph signal processing? The convolution of the graph and pooling on the graph. Or what we can see is we have geometric graph. For example, this image can be modeled as a regular grid. We can do community detection here. We can node mapping, you can find out what nodes are connected. We can have, for example, this aeroplane can be modeled as a 3D point graph. Or this person clapping here can be modeled as an evolving graph, which is a 4D point graph. It's 4D dynamic point cloud. So we can see the evolution of the disease here, for example, in a particular community. How is the disease that can be modeled as a 4D or a dynamic point cloud? And what we want to do is graph convolution. We want to implement CNN on a graph. So first thing that we need to define, as I've already defined, that graph, that convolution can be taken as a message passing network. So a graph convolution network is followed by a pooling layer. What is pooling? Pooling drops some edges and drops some nodes. So we coarsen the graph into a subgraph, so what is happening, if you look at the figure, we have a graph, then we can have convolution of the graph, which changes the features of the nodes, because I'm considering the influence of my neighbors on me, it's doing message passing, and then I drop some nodes and some edges using some systematic way, which is called pooling. So, and then finally, I have some loss function, which is softmax here. I can have a readout layer which finds out what are the nodes and the features, and then use find out some node detection, edge detection, graph detection, use subgraph detection to do network analytics. So let's see, what is the input? The input is a graph. Then we do convolution, in which we consider the influence of the neighbors, WIHI. Then do pooling, in which we drop a lot of nodes and a lot of edges using some systematic way, retain what is important in decision making, those nodes and pooling. And this is what, my friends, is a graph convolution or a graph neural network. So how do we define the operations in a GNN or a graph neural network? We have graph convolution, in which, as you can see, we have the input adjacency matrix and every node. So we have the structure of the graph, which is given by the graph adjacency matrix. Each node is, there are n nodes in this particular graph. Each has b features, if you see my mouse. And then after doing convolution, what changes? A remains the same. Adjacency does not change because edges remain the same. But the nodes, the number of nodes remain the same, but their features become different. So we have d new instead of d. And how did we implement it? We have spectral convolution techniques, we have spatial. But for example, in a spatial convolution technique, we say that it's actually message passing. And so the graph convolution refines the nodes. Then we have graph pooling. So this is graph pooling, in which after convolution, we take, and then the graph pooling actually changes the adjacency graph. As you can see, a lot of nodes have been dropped, a lot of edges have been dropped. So what changes are the nodes and the structure of the graphs. I'll give you, take an example. For example, we take the karate club example, which is very, very popular example here, and we'll quickly browse through this particular example. So there is a karate club. You have two major stakeholders, Mr. Instructor and the administrator. Somehow there is a dispute and they want to split. The club splits into two clubs. And they are members, for example. This is the club on the left-hand side. And I want to predict who will go with the instructor, Mr. I, who will go with the administrator. So I repeat, we have a karate club in which we know that there are members. The members are close either to the instructor or to the administrator or both. And they are connected, so it's a graph. I want to find out if the graph splits, who will go with Mr. Instructor or Mr. High, or who will go with the administrator. So, for example, I'm showing you the GNN output itself. So this is the original graph. I want to partition this graph. So I'm doing community detection using network analytics. So this is a social graph. So we know that who talks to whom first. So we have 34 people here. And we have the administrator and we have Mr. High. Mr. High is the instructor, who's in red. And we have the administrator, who is there in purple. Using GNN, we should be in a position to partition the network to find out who will go with Mr. High, who's the instructor, or who will go with the administrator. And here are the results on the last hand side. But let's look at it in a little more detail. So what we do is, in GNN, we have the input of the graph, and this is the output of the first layer. So what we do is we have done message passing. The X are the nodes. We multiply it by the pre-multiplied by the adjacency matrix, post multiplication by a learnable weight passed through a non-linear sigmoid function. So we have the first output. Repeat this process again, go to the second layer, and then take the decisions. A loss function. So we are able to find out who two graphs who will go with a binary learning, either with Mr. High or not with Mr. High. And we are using propagation rule in GNN, and this is the final result. So let's see what we have done. To find out the club membership, we apply two hidden layers. And what is happening in the hidden layer? We are saying D is a degree matrix, H is the H cap is the adjacency matrix with self loop, H is the output from the previous layer, and W's are the random weights which are learnable through backpropagation. And this is how, as you can see, this graph transforms on the left hand side, transforms to the graph on the right hand side. So my friends, I will not go into details of GNN because that will take a full lecture, or more than one lecture. It's actually a group of lot many lectures. Let's look at the applications and how a network analytics can be done using graph-based learning or using GNN. But let's look at examples from varied fields and varied graphs that we have, and most of them I'm just showing you the application areas. I'm not going to details of the application areas, but let's see. So for example, in this is a paper and reported which is called Super Glue, and this came in 2020 ICML, I believe, no, in CVPR 2020, so it's not even 1 year. And this is called Magic Leap. What it does, it finds out the importance of a place by matching features and images. So for example, in this particular graph on the left hand side, we model this as a graph and match it and do matching with the node in the with the image in the right hand graph to be able to do the matching and then say that yes, this particular image on the right hand side is actually a part of the image in the left hand side. So what we have been able to do is do feature matching using Super Glue architecture, which is the GNN architecture, which is able to learn feature matching using graph neural networks between different images. So I am able to find out though the angle, the orientation, the daylighting, everything between these two images are different. They are taken at different times of the day, different photographer, different lighting conditions, different resolution, different focusing, but we are able to match using GNN. For example, in the come to the world of physics, we are doing network analytics in the world of physics. So for example, in the Large Hadron Detector, remember this is the Hadron Collider which made news because of the God's particle, Large Hadron Detector using boson. What they did was they used GNN or GraphML into real-time data processing to process billions of collisions per second and to be able to track a particular particle. So they are able to track a particular particle to find out how does it evolve, what are the new particles which are generated, how does this new the old particle move, and wherein the evolution of the graph to be able to predict if new particles like God's particles come into existence or they are there which influence the motion of the particles. So what we need to do is we need to do real-time data processing of billions of collisions, so that, and if the trajectory of the path of the trajectory of the node, sorry, the particle changes, then we can analyze and say, okay, there must be some particle with which it has collided, and that particular particle should have these characteristics, so that we are in a position to predict the existence of new particles by seeing the evolution of the graph, the how does the node behave, how does changing. For example, GNNs have been used for disease classification. For example, you have imaging data, we have the phenotype data, and then you do feature mapping. Then you will say, okay, what type of disease is going to spread in what type of community? So I can do model the graph. For example, you can model the graph as a bipartite graph, and then I can do disease classification using GNN learning or GCN learning, called semi-supervised learning, on this particular graph to be able to predict, what is the disease and what are the and do disease classification using network analytics, using graph. Similarly, if you want to design drugs, if you want to design vaccines, if you want to design a new COVID drug, for example, then I must have a network, I must have a technique, and this particular massive, again, reported in 2020, it is able to find out different protein binders from a cancerous site on oncological target, so that we are able to find out where is the protein binding to what sites, so that we are able to find out. For example, in the COVID vaccines that we have, we find out that the vaccine actually goes and targets and attaches itself to the ACE inhibitor, and the ACE protein interacts with this so that the ACE protein is no longer available for the coronavirus. For example, in the coronavirus, it is able to bind with the spike protein. The spike protein is now not able to bind with the ACE protein, and hence the virus is not able to replicate. So if we can do this and predict this, then probably we'll be in a position to design better vaccines, better drugs. And for example, in this case, what we have done is we have been able to find out the whole thing as a mesh-based molecular surface, and we are able to learn patterns using GNN, which allow us to predict the interaction between proteins with other proteins, and find out how the protein, where, which site the protein is going to dock. So, and we can speed up this process and design a particular vaccine. You know, in this COVID times, we want to design good vaccines, good drugs, and do it not in the chemical route, because that takes years, but on the computer, and this can be done using network analytics. Similarly, I can do polypharmacy side effect prediction. So I know these drugs, for example, these antibiotics are there, so that we know which antibiotic is close to which other antibiotic on the graph, and find out the side effects, because I can predict the link between the drug and the side effect, and by predicting the link or the subgraph, I can predict the side effect of a particular new antibiotic or particular drug. And side effects, we know, are creating a lot of problems in vaccines, in drugs. So if you can predict them, probably we can take action and not discover it after 8 months, 10 months, or when the entire country has been inoculated and vaccinated. Then we find out of a particular side effect. It's better that we are in a position to predict using network analytics, using GNN. Again, this paper came into 2021, in which graph community detection on graph neural networks. So a weighted graph attention network has been used for, I will not go into details, for community detection. What it does, it uses a metapath and defines a metapath to capture the potential characteristics of nodes, do clustering, and then classification. Again, there is again one paper which has come in Transactions in 2021, which uses again graph convolutional networks on an evolving graph. So there's a dynamic change. The communities are changing. For example, the drug is evolving, or the community is changing, and we have different types of the real world data graph, in which the nodes are heterogeneous. We have drugs, we have viruses, we have human beings, and we want to predict the community. Then we have temporal heterogeneous graph convolution networks, which can be used to define communities using GCN. So what it does, I'll just take 2 minutes on this. What it does is that the communities are detected using the graph representation and their connections. So what we do is we first design a heterogeneous GCN to represent features and do convolution and pooling. And then we have a second unit, which is called residual compressed aggregation component, which learns the change, which learns the temporal feature representation. And the whole thing looks like this. So we have multiple GCNs, and then at different time steps, we learn the through convolution and pooling, learn the network, the node features, then pass it to the second part, which is the RESCAC, which is the residual compressed aggregation component, which uses attention to do community detection. So as I said, we have, what we do here is we embed graph structures, and since there are two types of graph structures, one is the structural information, again the node features, we do node convolution, and then output of the GCN, one hop GCN, is given to the second structure, which is the residual structure, and it does community detection using a loss function. And the this residual compressed component has three parts. I'm not again going to detail, and this is how it looks like. So we are in a position to do community detection using on a dynamic evolving graph. How is the community changing? How is the community evolving? What are the communities using this temporal GCN? And how do we really detect the communities? That is done by using a loss function. In addition to these, I'll just take another 10 minutes. So in addition to these, we can use these graph neural networks for recommendations. For example, in a recommendation, what we have users, we have items. And then in the recommendation systems, we can generate a list of recommendation items. What are the items we recommend to a particular user? For example, we can recommend Dr. Manish Kumar is here. We can, by looking at his the graph, we can recommend that we recommend him to buy a football. We recommend him to buy sports items. And we also recommend him to organize a lot of other good FTPs. So we can give a list of recommendations. And these list set of recommendations are movies, groceries, web pages, research papers, workshops, and so forth. And for this, we have different kinds of graph neural networks. For example, GNNs, user item interaction. So we have a bipartite graph. We can have GNN enhanced with social network information. And then we can have GNNs with knowledge graphs. I'll just show them. Example, we have GNN recommendation, a general recommendation. Using bipartite graphs, we can have time sequential recommendation using temporal GNNs. For example, I will again try to be a little quick, not show this, but then let's look. This, for example, this is a bipartite graph in which we have the nodes on the left-hand side, we have the content on the right-hand side, and for enhanced network, we can have a social network together with the item network. Both of them can be used in a GNN to be able to do convolution and pooling, and then generate recommendations using the output. Again, we can have a knowledge graph. Knowledge graph can be used, and these can be combined. For example, the item graph and the social graph can be combined and applied to GNN as a unified network to propagate information and to learn. So, as I said, what we can do is we can use GNNs, and we can have the user item network, which is a bipartite network, social network of the individual person, both of them can be used separately, given to a GNN to predict the user preferences or recommendations. We can turn them into one graph and then use that graph for recommendations using GNN, that can be another approach. And these approaches, both the approaches, have become very, very popular. And they're giving excellent results. And the traditional graph techniques are also being combined, also being used in these GNNs for better results. In the, if you have evolving graph, that then you can model users' dynamic preferences using these sequential behaviors. Again, we have a work which is able to do group sequential recommendation that came in 2020, in which the evolving behavior, the user's behavior sequence is generated. These are the items, and then we can have GNN, which can then do the sequential modeling and then predict the next preference. So the time series, the evolving preferences of a person, the changing behavior of a particular person with time can be predicted, and recommendations can be made on the basis of that. For example, me as a student, then evolved as a faculty, then I have become senior, and then my tastes have changed. So my behavior keeps on changing, and this can be predicted by using temporal graph neural networks. So what do we conclude? So the conclusion is that deep learning networks like graph neural networks, the variational autoencoders, and GNNs, they are being used in a big way in network analytics. So, for example, we have already seen graph neural networks. And in graph neural networks, both the static graph neural network and the temporal or the dynamic GNNs are being used. And we are in a position to predict both the evolving behavior of a particular person, the community, the node prediction, the edge prediction, the subgraph prediction for finding out a group of people who may be doing something wrong or doing something something different. We have applications in physics, we have applications in the medical world, we have application in policing, we have application of data networks. In data networks itself, in wireless networks, we can find which node is going to misbehave, where there is more congestion, what is the link which is going to be used more. On a transport network, we can fuse the sensor information coming from different sensors for autonomous driving. For example, if you look at the autonomous driving techniques which are being proposed nowadays, most of them are using graph neural networks. Or what we can do is, suppose we have very small amount of data. For example, the accident data or the congestion data on the road is far less. Then we can use, for example, the adversarial networks. For example, you can use GCAN instead of GNN. We can use GANs for data augmentation and do transfer learning, as Dr. KP Singh has told you. So if you have paucity of data, we can learn the underlying distribution of the data using variational autoencoders. Or we can generate samples which follow the same distribution using GANs. So the time has come that we combine the classical techniques, for example, centrality indices, the connectivity indices, all of them have become very, very important. They can be combined together with deep learning techniques. Deep learning techniques like GNN can be combined together with variational autoencoders, with GNNs, to have better learning. So, my friends, we have a long way to go, but these are exciting times. You can go in for GNN, you can work on the techniques, you can work on you can work on the applications, you can choose applications, you can do network analytics, whether you are in electronics engineering, you're in communication engineering, you are in BLSI, you are in medical world, you are doing VANETs, you are into social work, you are doing some social recommender systems, you are working on IoT, you are working on image analysis, you are working on cognitive, be any branch of knowledge, you are in physics, you are in chemistry, you are in biology, any work There are many key challenges that need to be addressed. We in machine learning world do not know the challenges. We want challenges. We want to change these neural techniques. We want to change deep learning techniques. We want to evolve them, but we need feedback from applications. Feedback, the application people need to know what are the techniques, and through these need to be evolved. There are many challenges that need to be addressed. There, we have got wonderful results, but still a lot of things need to be done. So thank you, my friends. I think I'll give